So it was a great summary already. Today I'll be talking about research challenges in devising next generation information retrieval and access systems. What do I mean by next generation information retrieval and access systems? So basically, as you know, during the last few years, especially the last 4 or 5 years or so, the way we access information has changed significantly. 10 years ago or so, when people thought about searching, they all mostly thought about searching through a desktop machine or searching using their laptops. But during the last few years, what has happened is the devices that we use to access information available online has become much smaller. Now we have intelligent assistants, we have mobile phones, we have smart glasses, smart watches, and so on. This comes with a kind of a different perspective and lots of different expectations from users, in particular because the interfaces that people now access information are much smaller, which means that it's very challenging or very difficult for people to modify their queries, to give feedback to the system, or in general to interact with these systems. What this means is that now that these interfaces changed, it means that people have very different expectations from these systems, and therefore we have to think about the design of these information retrieval and access systems differently. So before it was mainly search, but now we need something that is smaller. In particular, we need systems that can provide the users with the information they need with as little effort as possible. And in today's talk, I'll be talking a little bit about what research challenges exist regarding re reducing this effort needed to access information, as well as some of the research that we have done in this context. So another challenge that now we see in our everyday lives is that people, these devices are the main way people access information and people access the news. And if the information provided by these devices are incorrect or biased, they may have a lot of effect in the way society works, society thinks, and in the long run, it may change lots of things in an unreliable and unfair manner. So another kind of direction that needs to be tackled is now that we have made these devices more accessible or accessible with less effort, we also need to make sure that the information provided by these devices is correct and unbiased. And in today's talk, I will be talking about the research challenges that needs to be tackled in context of these two lines of work that I believe will need to be addressed in the next few years, and the research we have done in that context. So first, I'll be talking about what I call task-based information retrieval and access systems. And these are systems basically that enable users to complete their everyday tasks with as little information from the users as possible. And in this context, I'll be talking about two research challenges, task extraction and representation, as well as task-based personalization, which I'll describe later in this talk, what I specifically mean by this. And then in the second part of my talk, I'll be talking about the need for building methodologies for detection of misinformation and bias, and some of the methods we have built in that context. In particular, I'll be talking about some algorithms we have built for automatic detection of misinformation in the web, as well as for automatic evaluation of bias in search engine results. So this is the outline of my talk. Basically, so in the first half of my talk, I would like to talk about task-based information retrieval and access systems, why they are important and what are they. Before I start talking about that, let's first take a look a little bit into the traditional approach information retrieval and access systems work. And it's actually currently, I mean, I'm calling it traditional, but still most information retrieval and access systems work in this manner. So most information retrieval and access systems, such as search engines or intelligent assistants, the methods used by these systems, are based on the assumption that relevance should be the primary focus in information retrieval and access. Given a query submitted by the user or an utterance, the goal of most of these systems is to identify information that is relevant to this query or utterance submitted by the user. This is a principle used by search engines, by intelligent assistants, and in general in information retrieval and access system design. The assumption here is that if we had improved relevance, if the results were more relevant, that would lead to improved user satisfaction. But there is an important aspect that is missing in this assumption, which is that normally people use information retrieval and access systems to complete their everyday tasks. Like they may be opening up a search engine or asking an intelligent assistant things like, okay, I would like to book my travels to London, flights to London, for example. But what they would like to do is not necessarily get information relevant to flights to London. What they would like to do is they would like to complete their entire travel booking task. And with current systems, because the systems just focus on identifying or retrieving relevant information, the person, the user themselves have to identify what are the different subtasks I need to complete when I if I would like to complete this travel booking task, and the person has to submit all separate queries to the system. For example, if they are planning booking their travels to London, they have to submit a separate query for booking flights to London, another one for hotels in London, another one for possibly to book transportation from the flight to the hotel, from the airport to the hotel, or weather forecast, and so on. And because of the reason for this is the system is just focusing on returning relevant information with respect to the query submitted by the user, as opposed to helping the user complete the underlying task. And this causes a lot of effort from, this requires a lot of effort from user point of view, because they have to identify all the subtasks associated with the task they would like to do and submit separate queries for each of them. To kind of quantify this, what we have done is we have tried to see, okay, can we quantify how many queries people have to submit if in a search engine if they would like to achieve one of their everyday complete one of their everyday tasks? How much time do they have to spend in a search engine, and how many page views do they have to perform? And here you can see numbers, some numbers, and this is actually based on a user study that was done over a 1 month period. In fact, there are quite a few tasks that people perform on the web that are much more complex, like buying a house and so on. So these numbers that you see are kind of lower bounds on what on the number of queries or amount of effort spent by the users, because quite a few of them would still continue after this 1 month period. But what our research has shown is that most users on average tend to issue 7 queries per task, and they would need to spend approximately 44 minutes per task with 25 page views per task. And again, one of the primary reasons for this is this assumption that relevance is the key that the information system, information retrieval and access systems need to focus on, as opposed to focusing on systems focusing on helping users complete their tasks, underlying tasks. So what I believe is one of the main research challenges that we as a community have to tackle is to devise next generation intelligent online services that can go beyond this assumption that the query is given by the user, we just return relevant information to the query, that can go beyond the input from the user, and that can automatically detect the task the user is trying to achieve given any sort of input from the user, and that can provide the user with contextual task completion assistance. So not retrieve just results relevant to the query, but retrieve all sorts of different types of results that are relevant to the different subtasks associated with the task. Now, there are three main challenges associated with the design of such systems. In fact, if you think about it, if we go towards the design of such systems, it's quite a challenging task, because we really need to start thinking about information retrieval and access differently, which means different interfaces, different way of interaction possibilities from the users, and different way of feedback mechanisms from the users. But three main challenges that I see that we first need to tackle are, the first one is task extraction and representation, which is, given an input from the user, how can I automatically identify what task the user is trying to perform? And how do I represent this task? And how do I identify and represent the subtask associated with this task? So that's one key research challenge. And the second key research challenge is, now that we have formed representations of tasks, how do we personalize the results presented to the user? In a sense, we would like our final goal is to make sure that we can provide the user with relevant, with correct information, with as little effort as possible from the user point of view. And especially given that, considering that this type of devices will be used by through devices that have very small screens, or that are very difficult for the user to interact with, like smart glass or smartwatch, for example, it's very critical to provide the person with the correct information and correct personalized information, because most tasks people tend to perform tend to be specific for that person. And the third important line of work that needs to be tackled is task-based evaluation of retrieval systems. Now that we are moving towards construction or development of task-based retrieval systems, we need to qualify, we need some methodologies that can help us quantify what a better task-based retrieval system is. Without a way of evaluating the quality of task-based systems, we can't build a better task-based retrieval system. So evaluation is really the key. It really sits at the center of all the research that is being done. So in this talk, I'll mainly focus on the research that we have done in the first two parts of this. And we have done lots of work related to the evaluation part, which I won't be able to cover because of time restrictions. So the very first work that needs to be done in context of task-based retrieval system design is task extraction and task representation. Given a query from the user, how do I identify what task they may be trying to do? And what are the subtasks associated with it? So for this purpose, one thing that can be done is to look at, basically, as you know, people use search engines or intelligent assistants for lots of different tasks they would like to perform online. And queries that are previously issued by these other users contain a lot of information about the type of tasks users use these systems for. They contain a lot of information about what type of tasks people perform on these devices. But not only that, they also contain a lot of information about what are the subtasks associated with these tasks. Because you would see that a person who has started querying for things like flights to London, they would quite likely follow up with queries like hotels in London, or in maybe later on weather forecast in London, and so on. So what we can do is we can look at this user behavior data, and then we can use machine learning techniques to infer task representations from these very large query logs. So basically, this is what we are trying to do. And you can see an example task extraction and task representation that we use in our research. So let's assume that the user came up with a query to the search engine with the query of like mortgage interest rates. And what we would like to do is we would like to automatically map this query to the task of buying a house. And we would like to also automatically identify the subtask associated with buying a house, which could be like getting a mortgage, finding a solicitor, renovating the interior, and so on. And some of these subtasks themselves may consist of several sub-subtasks. And we would like to ideally identify the whole hierarchy of tasks here. As far as we are concerned, when we build these devices, we don't necessarily need the tags or the labels associated with each of these tags. But what we can do is we can basically build a tree-like structure where each node corresponds to a task or a subtask, and each node can be represented as a cluster of queries that other people have issued to the system to complete their tasks. And that's the main representation that we will be using, because that way we don't have to annotate each node with the task title or task label, but we can just form representations automatically by just clustering queries that people have issued to complete these tasks or subtasks. So one possibility in the, that we could through which we could perform these representations could be by using traditional hierarchical clustering methods. But most of these methods result in binary tree representations of data. And there are no guide on the correct number of clusters that these methods can generate. As you have seen in the previous slide, which I'll go back and show again, A binary tree representation wouldn't necessarily give us a good representation for task-subtask relationships, because each task can consist of several subtasks and varying number of subtasks actually. And we would like to be able to capture this varying number of children that each node may have in our representation. And ideally, we would like some sort of methodology that can also give us a guide on the correct number of clusters or correct number of subtasks that each task consists of, given previous large-scale usage data. And another challenge with these techniques is that we need methods that can represent trees with these arbitrary branches. And we should be able to infer these trees in a very efficient way, because we are dealing with very large query logs, which can come from months and months of usage data. And complexity is a major problem. So we would like to make this inference of this task subtask representation as efficient as possible. So for this, we have done basically two lines of work. Our initial research has focused on using hierarchical task, constructing these hierarchical task representations using some tree representations called Bayesian rose trees. So basically, rose trees are tree representations where each node of the tree can have arbitrary number of children, which is exactly the representation that we would like to have in context of this task extraction or task representation. And we have developed some algorithms that are based on Bayesian methods that can construct these trees in an efficient way. And that can also give us this tree structures with arbitrary number of children. And building upon this work, our most recent research on this is actually to convert these representations towards some sort of action-oriented knowledge graph, so that once we have these representations, task-subtask relationships constructed, we can potentially share it with the community and people can just make use of these task-subtask representations to build any sort of task completion assistance. It can even be used by a robot who helps the user complete the task from the beginning till the end. It doesn't have to be a search engine or an intelligent assistant. So I'll just like to give you a brief summary of kind of the technique that we have used regarding hierarchical task extraction, because it does sit on the basis of lots of research we have conducted. So basically, our goal here is to build these rose tree representations and to do it in an efficient way. And for that, there is some recent work. Our recent work has focused on using this Bayesian rose tree approach, which is trying to construct these rose tree representations given the data. So basically, the way this is approached is based on this research by Blundell et al., previous research that tried to construct these Bayesian rose trees in an efficient way. We have extended this work towards the problem of constructing task representations in an efficient way. And the way that the method by Blundell et al. Is, works is basically how do I find tree representations that maximize the probability of data observed given the tree representation. So basically, classical Bayesian way. What we did is basically we have extended this work for the purposes of task extraction. So in our representations, a tree is basically represented as a mixture of partitions pi over a group of queries, where each node in our tree corresponds to a task, and each task or each node in our tree representation is represented by a set of queries. And then our goal is to find a tree structure that maximizes the probability of queries observed by many different users in our query logs, given the tree structure. I'm not going to get into the details of the inference of that, but basically, this is done via dynamic programming, it gives you a nice approximation, a reasonable quality approximation, and by just kind of iteratively constructing the tree representation at each node. Okay, so given this, one thing we wanted to check is, okay, we have constructed this task representations, are they of any use? Are they reasonable representations? And to check that, one thing we did is to try to kind of to be a bit futuristic. In a sense, what we want to do with these task representations is to minimize the effort needed by the users. So hopefully, by using these representations, the users shouldn't have to issue many more queries in the future because the system should be able to detect what the user is trying to do. And our task representations should be able to capture what the user is trying to do so that the user shouldn't have to issue further queries in the future. And with that in mind, the way we evaluated our methods, our task representations, is that we looked at like some previous K queries in time. And then given these previous queries by the user, we mapped the user to our task representation space, where tasks are inferred by using lots of usage data from other users. So given this user, we mapped, and given the history of the previous K queries issued by the user, we mapped the user to some task representation space, and we try to predict the future queries that the user is likely to issue. So if we are able to map the user correctly to a correct task representation, then we should be able to predict by looking at our task representation, we should be able to accurately predict what future queries the user may be issuing. And if we can accurately predict these future queries, this is great because then we can build a system where the user doesn't have to issue these queries. The system just takes care of it. So that's how we evaluated the quality of our task extraction mechanisms. You see several methods here. I won't get into details of them, but there was already some work beforehand, mostly looking at session instead of tasks, just like splitting things based on queries that fall in the same time window and kind of like a sequence of queries that people issue to complete a similar task, but within a limited time window. And here with this work, we go beyond that and we kind of aggregate information that can go beyond the same time window because certain tasks tend to span multiple days or months. And so basically we compared our hierarchical task extraction method with this previous work, and you can see that this is the red line here. We can much more accurately predict the future queries that people may issue for task to complete their tasks. Okay, so that was one thing, and that was kind of sitting at the basis of lots of work that was done, because if you can't represent a task properly, you can't really build a task-based retrieval system. And then the next step, now that we have some sort of reasonable representations for task, is task-based personalization. So basically, personalization is critical for devising systems that are closer to understanding user needs, because depending on the time of the day, depending on the profile of the users, users tend to be interested in certain tasks when they use IR systems. And they may not necessarily be interested in, not all users would be interested in all subtasks. Some subtasks may be optional, or some users may have very different expectations from the system, even if they are, for example, travel booking. Some people never check like points of interest when they travel somewhere, for example. So then what we can do is we can represent users in terms of the task they are interested in and personalize results based on that. And so basically, if you have, I'm sure there are some people in the audience that have worked on personalization. The traditional approach in personalization is topic-based. So you could basically either have some predefined topical categories like finance, basketball, jazz, like ODP categories, in case some people are familiar with, or you could infer these topical representations automatically by looking at, again, large-scale data through things like LDA. And then once you have these topics, you can represent the people in terms of the topics that they are interested in by looking at their history, or you could apply things like matrix factorization, for example, to infer people's topic-specific interests. But topics are not necessarily enough to capture a user's personal interest. Like just in this example, for example, you see two different people, the top two people, who are both interested in the domain of finance. And the first person may be a financial broker, so they may be interested in also things like stock market predictions. They may be continuously reading financial news and things like that. The other person may be like a simple person who just has very little money to invest, and they are trying to see where they should be investing in the next few days. And so they may be just starting to read financial news. So someone who is interested in stock market in context of finance will have very different task specific interests, task based interests with respect to the domain of finance, than someone who just has very little money and who is not necessarily interested in stock market, for example. Therefore, actually, topics are not enough to represent users' interests. We need to go beyond topics, and we need to ideally represent users in terms of their topic-specific task interests, and which is what we have done. So basically, we have constructed a three-dimensional tensor where one dimension is the users, the other dimension is topics, and the third dimension is the tasks. And then using this representation, then, for example, a typical way of doing personalization in context of topic-based personalization, the traditional technique that is commonly used is if you have a matrix where one dimension is user, one dimension is the topic, you could use matrix factorization to infer a kind of a user's topical interest, the latent representations of that. And then based on that, you just do personalization. So we go one step beyond that and we construct tensor-based representation. And we, instead of matrix factorization, we can now do tensor factorization to infer users' topic-specific task interests. Okay, so that's kind of one mechanism that we have built for personalizing these task-based information retrieval and access systems. And then we would like to see how well do these methods perform. And we again conducted a similar approach for evaluating the quality of these personalization algorithms. But we did it in a slightly different way as well. So again, what we wanted to do is, given the user, we would like to see how well can our methods, personalization algorithms, predict the future queries and issued by the user. Similar approach, we use evaluation for task representation. But the way we tackle this is we first, through tensor factorization, we first identified users' topic-specific task interests. And then based on these representations, we identified what are the most similar users that look similar to the current users in terms of their topic-specific task interest. So in the x-axis here, you see the number of similar users that we identified, the top similar users that we use to identify users that are similar to the current user. And then given this, given the query, basically we identify what have these other users that look similar to the current user have issued with respect to this task. And then based on that, we predict what may be the future tasks that the person may be issuing, the future queries that this person may be issuing. So that's how we evaluate the quality of our results. And you see quite interesting results here, actually. So the traditional topic-based method is the pink bar here. And our tensor factorization and the topic-specific task interest-based modeling is the blue one here. And you can see a huge improvement compared to traditional topic-based personalization. And we also checked, okay, what if we completely got rid of topical representation and we just represented each person based on their task-specific interest, how would the result would look like? And that's the red one here. As you can see, ignoring the topics and moving to task-based representations of user interests already gives improvements compared to traditional topic-based representation of users. But of course, topic-specific task interests, the tensor-based representations, they give us much better results, which is the blue line here. Okay, so this is I just wanted to give you an idea about some of the research challenges that we have tackled in the design of task-based retrieval systems. And we are still continuing working on this because it's nowhere near to be solved. I think it's relatively recent research area and there is a lot to be done because we really have to change the way information retrieval and access systems have been designed if you want to design a complete task completion agent. And currently, we are investigating several lines of work related to this. One is utilizing semi-structured information in the web for task-based conversational assistance. Basically, in the web, you already see a lot of information about the steps that people need to complete given a task It's already there. There are some semi-structured websites that you can use to infer these subtasks given a task, and we are looking at incorporating that to our systems. And we have done quite a bit of work related to task-based evaluation of retrieval systems, because as I mentioned, task-based evaluation is really critical. If you want to build task-based retrieval systems, we need to be able to quantify what a better retrieval system is. I have led the organization of TREC Task Track, which was funded by National Institute of Standards Technology, where we focused on building evaluation methodologies and also building data sets and making these data sets publicly available so that the community can use these methodologies and data sets for task-based evaluation of retrieval systems. And we still have some ongoing work related to this. Finally, now that we have these representations, we have these personalization algorithms and so on, a critical part is the user interfaces. How do we present this information to the users? Our goal is to make sure that the users are not annoyed by these systems, because sometimes these systems need to be proactive, and sometimes the user may not like these proactive systems. So they have to be very carefully designed. And when and how to ask questions or how to communicate, when and how to communicate with the end user is critical. And also, how do you design a user interface that is much easier for the user to use such task-based systems is critical. I think that will be the main point, the main research challenge that needs to be tackled in the next few years, which we are trying to investigate. Okay, so now I would like to switch gears a little bit, because in the first part of my talk, I mainly focused on reducing effort needed by the users in using the next generation information retrieval and access systems. Another important part that I believe needs to be tackled in the near future is fake and biased information online. So these go hand in hand, because now that users are using all these information retrieval and access systems, we have to make sure that the information provided by these systems are correct and reliable and unbiased. And this is particularly important because I think incorrect and biased information in general could have a significant effect on the society. We might have already seen some of this happening. And in the future, we may have a lot more coming up related to this. And also, now that a lot of the processes, a lot of the tasks will be automated, and some of the decisions will be made by artificial intelligence, having such bias or having such incorrect information also makes people not trust this type of systems. And we may get lots of people questioning these systems, maybe lots of court cases and so on. So we really have to make sure that information provided is correct and unbiased. What are some types of effects if we had systems that provided incorrect or biased information? They could basically have effects things such as like changing political election results, perturbing stock markets, manipulating individual awareness and individuals' awareness and so on. And like I said, we might have already seen some of this happening. So then the question is, how can we automatically detect misinformation and bias? So apart from the need for reducing the effort needed from the users when they use information retrieval and access systems, which I tackled in the first part of my talk, now in the second part of my talk, I would like to give you a small overview of the research that we do in context of automatic detection of misinformation and automatic evaluation of bias. So first, misinformation detection, which is automated fact-checking. So basically what we did in context of this work is to basically try to automatically classify a claim or a piece of text as true, false, or unverified. So this could be a news article, this could be a tweet, this could be a claim made by a politician or anything. And then in context of this, there are two types of methods that we have investigated. So basically, given a claim or something posted in social media or in a newspaper article, one thing that you can see happening is people start posting replies, people comments to these claims in Facebook, for example, or Twitter or any social media platform. People start replying, and people's replies contain a lot of information about the truthfulness of the original claim made. So one line of work that we have done focuses on using people's replies or comments to a claim made in order to infer the truthfulness of the claim. Then one challenge with this approach, though, is that this people start responding or posting comments to the claim, time also passes. And ideally, you need algorithms that can detect misinformation as quickly as possible, because you don't want many people to be exposed to this information. You would like to ideally be able to get rid of this information as quickly as possible if it is incorrect information. So if you wait for people to post comments, that may be a little late potentially. Another way of doing this fact checking is to basically, given a claim, is to search online, perform a search and gather all the search results and identify the stance of evidence or stance of documents retrieved in these search results with respect to the claim. Do the documents available in the web support this claim? Do they disagree with this claim, and so on? Then based on this agreement of the documents in the web with the claim made, you can make inference as to whether the claim is true or false. Okay, so basically, I would like to give you an overview of the research we have done with respect to both of these aspects. One of them is how can we use people's comments in order to predict if the claim made in the news article or claim in the comment in social media is correct. Basically, what we have done is we can look at people's comments, and the interesting thing is most controversial or most claims that are not correct, they would raise lots of discussion by people. There would be comments, lots of viewpoints, lots of emotion expressed, and in general, most recent comments would be the most informative. So for that, basically, to capture all of this, we have built a Bayesian deep learning model that basically captures all of these aspects of the reviews. So basically, what this model does is it first encodes the claim made using a bidirectional STM to generate a prior belief about the veracity of the claim. Is this a prior belief as to whether the claim is correct or not? And then encoding people's replies using a bidirectional STM in a similar manner, and then classifying the veracity of the original claim and replies by using a multilayer perceptron. So basically, we have here's an overview of the model. I know I don't have too much time left, so I'll give you a very quick overview on this. So we have a claim encoder that generates some prior belief, some distribution prior belief as to whether the claim may be correct or not. Then we have a replies encoder, which is encoded in a very similar way to the claims, but it's also on top of all the representation that is based on by LSTM, we also use an LSTM so that we give more weight to the most recent replies compared to the older ones. And then we update our original belief as to whether the claim was correct or not based on the claim encoder by using the information from the replies encoder. The good thing about doing this in a Bayesian way is that most replies tend to be very noisy, and that way you can also, the method is less, more robust to the noise available in the replies. So I'm not going to get into too much detail about the evaluation results here, but we do get quite good evaluation results compared to existing methods. And again, another line of work that we have done related to this is stance detection, where, just like I mentioned, if you wait for people to start posting comments to a claim, you have to wait quite a bit of time sometimes, because people may react not very soon. And ideally, you should have algorithms that you can use to be able to detect the truthfulness of a claim made as quickly as possible. So another algorithm that we have built is based on using retrieval techniques to first retrieve evidence that is related to the claim made, and then you develop automatic stance detection algorithms to be able to automatically detect, does this document agree with the claim made, disagree with the claim made, or it's not really relevant, for example. So here's the problem in stance detection, basically. As I mentioned, documents available in the web can be highly informative regarding the veracity of a claim. And the task in stance detection is to classify the stance of a document towards a claim by checking as to whether this document agrees with the claim, which means the document fully supports the claim, disagrees with the claim, which means the document fully disagrees or denies the claim, whether it discusses the claim, which means that the document does not really have a particular position, it doesn't really agree or disagree with the claim, it's, you know, on a related topic with the claim, but there is no particular stance in here. So it's like just discussing the topic. And finally, the document may be unrelated, which means the document is not really relevant, it's on a completely different topic. If a claim is about politics, it may be about coffee, for example. So the task in stance detection is to classify the stance of a document towards a claim based on these four categories. One challenge with the stance detection task that makes our research very valuable in this context is that there is a severe class imbalance with respect to all these four categories. Because as you might know, anyone who worked with search engine research on for search engine research or intelligent assistants, they would know that information in the web is highly biased. So given a query, you would get lots of unrelated documents, but very few related documents to that query. And in this context, it's the same. Given a claim, there will be lots of documents that are on completely unrelated topics in the web. There will be very few documents that are relevant to the claim, meaning they are on the same topic about the claim, and they agree, disagree, or discuss about the claim. So there is a huge class imbalance here, and that's what the training and test data sets that that are constructed for this purpose also show. And another important thing about this this problem is that there is a hierarchical structure between the classes, actually, where unrelated is a completely different category, whereas agree, disagree, and discuss can be combined together on a related category. So basically, for a document to agree, disagree, or discuss about a claim, it has to be first related to the claim, meaning they are on the same topic. And this hierarchical structure is completely ignored by existing methods, which most existing methods basically just did focus on directly predicting each of these classes right away, which meant that they suffered a lot from class imbalance issue, where they perform quite well on predicting the unrelated class, but they would perform very poorly on predicting the agree and disagree classes, which are the classes that you need to identify or you need to correctly predict, because those are the classes that give you information as to whether the claim is correct or not. Now, unrelated documents are not really useful for this task. So for this purpose, we built a hierarchical two-layer stance detection model, where the first layer aims at identifying the relatedness. So the question that we ask here is this document relevant to the claim or not? Is it on a similar topic or not? Then on top of this, if the document is relevant to the claim, it is then sent to the second layer, which aims at classifying as to whether this document agrees, discusses, or disagrees with the claim. So, and that made a huge difference in terms of the prediction quality that we get. Here you see an overview of the method. So basically the first layer, the relatedness layer here, just focusing on predicting, is this document relevant to the claim made or not? And if the output of this layer is yes, it is relevant, then the output, the document is sent to the stance layer, which tries to predict, does it agree, disagree, or discusses about the claim. And one important component, which I won't be able to discuss much of this because of the time, is the regularization. So basically we have a MMD regularizer here, which seemed to help quite a bit. Again, what our results show, I'll just briefly summarize. I know we are running out of time, so this is my last slide, hopefully, and I'll move on to questions. So here, I would like to emphasize the results. The last row here is our method. And I would like to draw attention to the performance of our algorithm on the agree and disagree classes here compared to all the other algorithms, which are the other rows, we get a huge improvement on agree and disagree classes just because of this hierarchical representation that we built. In fact, at the time this work was published, we got the best performance in a fake news detection task. Okay, so this is a summary. I wanted to discuss a little bit about the work we have done on detection of bias on ranked results, but for now I'll skip it. I'm happy to discuss it further if there are any questions related to this. And with that, I would like to conclude my talk. So basically in this talk, I try to attention to the fact that people now access information in a very different way than they used to 10 years ago. And therefore, we have to really need to start thinking about new versions of or next generation information retrieval and access systems that can reduce the effort needed from the user point of view, because people are using these systems with very small interface where interaction or feedback from the user may be very limited. And with that, I try to place kind of two challenges that we have been tackling in my research group. One is the design of task-based information retrieval and access systems. In particular, I talked about task extraction and representation, as well as task-based personalization. Then I try to switch gears a little bit and try to raise the importance of tackling the misinformation and bias available online. And I describe some of the methods that we have built in for that purpose. So that's the end of my talk. One thing I would like to emphasize here is that this is not just my work, it's collaborative work. I have a big group of PhD students and postdocs who have done a lot of the work that I described here, and I would like to thank them as well. And thanks everyone for listening.